their ace, Mike Mussina, on the mound.
And this ball game is underway as Tim Raines takes the strike. Raines, the switch hitter, has gone 3-for-10 in this series. You see the positioning in at third in case he tries to bunt down that way. Mussina, the 19-game winner. Fastball, a knuckle curve. Pretty good changeup. Raines has that one bounced in on him. And a ball and a strike.
Mussina really struggled because Davey Johnson, the manager of the Orioles, went to a four-man rotation as of August 1st. He did not like it. He felt he was overworked. And his numbers in the second half prove that.
Tim Raines with a one ball, one strike count. Zena's not pitched since last Friday. Both these pitchers with a week of rest and a base hit for Raines. So the Yankee leadoff batter, which changes from game to game, this time being Raines, is on with a base hit to start this ball game out.
Very similar to how it started at Yankee Stadium yesterday. I thought that was one of the turning points of the ball game. Things happen in the course of a ball game. The Yankees, three big hits right in a row off of David Wells, and then Cecil comes up and hits into a double play. They only got two runs in that first inning. That was a crucial situation for David Wells.
Mike Mussina has now got to work from the stretch. Very tough to steal bases off him. He's got a very good move over there to first base. Won't pick a lot of people off, but you know, he'll look at you and keep you tight.
Yeah, they only attempted 14 stolen bases off Mussina the entire year.
We've had very little running in this series. Did not expect we would see much running in this series. Derek Jeter takes the pitch up high. And that'll be ball one. What a series he has put together. There you see the numbers, 13-for-27 in the playoffs this year. He is 6-for-10 in this series against Baltimore.
This kid's got to slap himself a couple of times. I mean, he's supposed to feel the pressure somewhat.
22 years old, playing at shortstop, one of the toughest positions on the field, and still getting it done with a bat. Raines being held by Palmeiro at first. Jeter chases another one up high. One ball, one strike. Fans will be in this one. Rick, they heard the first two games at Yankee Stadium and the 56,000 thundering. They want to respond to that for their team.
Very loud at Yankee Stadium, and they're trying to match that right here in the first inning.
You have a matchup not only of teams but of crowds as well, this great rivalry. And they'll have a sellout crowd here at Camden Yards tonight. 1-1 delivery, and Jeter goes to right field. Bobby Bonilla. Right. Home field advantage we talk about a lot in sports, Rick. How about this?
Yankees liked playing here this year. 6-0. They've had a lot of success since this ballpark was built. We talk about the Braves. That's going on in the National League where their series is tied one apiece. The Braves going into St. Louis now where they're also have not lost a ball game.
They have played 5 years worth of baseball here at Camden Yards. The Orioles have won 200 while losing 172. That's a 54 winning percentage. That's good, but not extraordinary.
Not like the Indians at Jacobs Field.
No.
In their new ballpark. They play about 700% winning baseball.
Bernie Williams runs on at first base, and a strike taken on the inside corner.
The thing with Mussina, his velocity is about 93, 94 miles an hour. To go along with that knuckle curve you mentioned, and the way you throw a knuckle curve, he just puts one knuckle on top, really a one-finger curveball. He gets a real tight rotation on it. But most of the hitters around the Yankee batting cage today were talking about his changeup.
Keeping hitters off stride. Tim Raines at first base. Palmeiro holds him there. Williams takes the off-speed pitch down low. One of the interesting things in this Yankee lineup, Rick, tonight is that Joe Torre has put in the big boppers all in the same game here, starting Strawberry, Cecil Fielder, Martinez.
He had to make a couple of moves. They've been leaving a lot of runners on base, not getting the big hit. They just wanted to try something different. O'Neill and Boggs both have been struggling with injuries. That has affected their hitting, so Torre wants to get Strawberry's bat in this ballpark.
And a strike taken. There's another one of those off-speed pitches to Bernie Williams. One ball, two strikes.
You know, maybe Torre wants to try to beat the Orioles at their own game by hitting home runs, and that's really not the Yankee style. There's Darryl Strawberry. He'll get four at bats tonight if it goes with the right hander.
It is a confine there. You can hit the ball out. And as the Yankee fans did, the Oriole fans are on their feet, cheering for a Mike Mussina strikeout. One ball, two strike count. Bernie Williams. 2-2. Raines leading it off with a single on at first base. And as we've seen in all three of these games now, in the start of the ball game, the pitchers have had to throw a lot of pitches early in the game. It's already happening to Mussina.
It almost looks like they're trying to make the two-strike pitch early in the count.
He's got a 2-2 count here on the red-hot Williams. Steps off, timeout taken as Raines goes back to the bag. 4-for-7 for Bernie Williams against the Baltimore Orioles. Offensively, he has really carried this ball club in the postseason. Hits and RBIs. 2-2. Inside, strike three call.
That's what happens if you start looking for Messina's off-speed pitches. His fastball is good enough to throw right by you. That time he spotted it on the inside part of the plate. It just froze Bernie Williams. See that ball right on the inside corner for strike three.
Only the fourth time he has struck out in 23 at bats in the playoffs this year. Mussina gets a big K in the hot hitter. Williams retired, and there are two down here in the first inning. Raines still on at first base. And here is Tino Martinez. Martinez is in the cleanup hole, but he is struggling right now. He's gone only 1-for-9 in this series. And in the playoffs, 5-for-24.
Well, you remember our first game. I talked about how important the number four hitter in the Yankee lineup is going to be. He has to drive in the runs if the Yankees want to go into the World Series.
Martinez will try and get that going here. Tino Martinez does not have an RBI in the postseason. Ouch.
Had 117 during the regular season.
There's that off speed pitch, just misses down low. Two ball count on Tino Martinez.
It's funny though, Joe Torre, the manager of the Yankees, before the game was saying feels that Martinez is ready to break out along with Cecil Fielder. He saw something in the game two yesterday that he said, okay, they're back.
See if in fact they are in this hitter's ballpark. A ground ball toward short, Cal Ripken over. Got a force at second to Alomar, and that'll do it. Yankees no runs on one hit. They leave a base runner on as Mussina gets the side out, and the Orioles are coming up. Baltimore, though, we are ready to go as Jimmy Key, the left-hander, 36 years old, faces Brady Anderson. And the pitch is taken down low for a ball. Brady Anderson, 3-for-9 in this series, noted for the home runs that he hits in the leadoff spot in the first at bat. He is always dangerous in these situations. Breaking ball by Key is outside, 2-0.
The one thing about Jimmy Key, does not give up many home runs to left-hand batters. Only one in his last 57 starts.
One this year, that was it. And a line drive right field, base hit in front of Darryl Strawberry. So both teams in the first inning get their leadoff batter on with a single.
Not a home run for Brady Anderson, but a base hit to get things going for the Orioles lineup. Take a look at the Yankees defense. Some changes. Hayes at third base for the Boggs. Strawberry's in right field for O'Neill. Duncan had a little tough time here earlier in the year. Three errors in one game. Yeah, that kind of helped make it a 15-inning ball game. But settle in. We're going to be here for a while. If you've seen our first two ball games, just get a nice recliner and watch the ball game.
4 hours and 24 minutes, a new record established in the ball game yesterday, game two for a 9-inning postseason. 4 hours and 13 minutes in game one. There is Wade Boggs in the middle of your picture, the bad back, and a bat that's not hot, maybe because of the bad back. He's out of the lineup.
One for 17 in postseason play. Joe Torre's looking for some action.
Todd Zeal, deep, good boy, home run, 2-0 Baltimore.
Breaking ball from Jimmy Key. Todd Zeal says, I'll handle that one, Joe Girardi. Look at down and in, second home run in 2 days.
And that electrifies the Oriole crowd. And a quick 2-0 lead as Todd Zeal delivers it. Well, we said Jimmy Key doesn't give them up to left-handers, only one, but he gave up 20. To right-handers. Add another one to that. As the Orioles' first two batters have crossed the plate. Alomar down to third. Charlie Hayes on the slow roller. Alomar retired, and that's the first out. What a start for the Orioles.
Well, that's exactly what they needed here at their home ballpark, because they've struggled against the Yankees. We talked about it. They have not beat the Yankees all year at home. They added some bats in their lineup in Zeal, and he's come through in the postseason with two big home runs in the last 2 days.
Davey Johnson's club relied on a record number of home runs for a team during the regular season. Joe Torre's pitching staff relied on not giving them up. That is one of the matchups in this game, a team that delivers home runs against a staff that had not given them up. Ripped by Palmeiro. That's a foul ball. You talk about a hot stick. To be expected, I guess, but he's steaming right now.
It's unbelievable. And it looks like there's no effort in his swing. Just relaxed. He gets the bat head through the hitting area as quick as anybody in baseball. The amazing thing about Palmeiro, I can't remember him taking bad swings. When's the last time you've seen him really look fooled on a pitch?
He's just on it, isn't he?
It's got to look the size of a beach ball.
Yeah. He's still in the summer mode here. Left-hander's pitch misses inside to him. Palmeiro's 4-for-7 against the Yankees. Overall in the playoffs, he's had 3 home runs and 5 RBIs for the Orioles. 2-0 lead on Zeal's home run. Should mention, Todd Zeal is the only player in the Baltimore lineup who had not faced Jimmy Key. That was his first at bat against Key, and he delivered a home run on it. The rest of the guys in the lineup have seen a lot of Jimmy Key over their careers. 3-1 to Palmeiro.
Most important thing for Jimmy Key is to work ahead in the count. Get hitters to chase his pitch, not fall behind where you have to come in with fastballs.
3-1 delivery. Palmeiro, center field, Bernie Williams. And there are two down.
You won't know the difference if Jimmy Key's given up 10 runs in an inning or he's got a no-hitter going through 7. Does not change.
One of the calmest composures in the game right there. Started game 3 of the division series at Texas. 5 innings, non-decision, a couple of runs on 5 hits in that game. Bobby Bonilla up and goes through that one. Strike 1. Boy, is he struggling right now.
A lot of breezes. Struck out 4 times Saturday in the division series, 4 times yesterday.
0-for-8 in this series. Takes the pitch, 1-ball, 1-strike. Bobby Bonilla's had problems going back to the end of the regular season. He's had only 4 hits in his last 42 at-bats. He's got great power, though. That one is fouled off. This ballpark yielded 229 home runs during the regular season. Baltimore had 121 of them. The opponents hit 108.
This is a bandbox. the ball flies out of here. The power alleys are not that deep.
Bobby Bonilla waiting, fouls it back. Ball and two strikes on him. Ironically for Bonilla playing here, he had only 9 home runs here and hit 19 on the road.
Well, that's what I thought also too with Brady Anderson. Hit only 19 here, 31 on the road. So their pitchers are giving up a lot of home runs here. Their hitters aren't taking advantage of this ballpark.
2-ball, 2-strike count.
Yeah, but how can you complain when a guy hits 50 home runs?
Nobody will if you're a Baltimore fan or associated with the team. There's Brady Anderson right there. Led off with a single and scored ahead of Zeal. Bonilla takes a breaking ball again outside, and it's a full count, 3-2.
That's the one thing the Orioles hitters have to do. They have to be patient against Jimmy Key. Make him come in the hitting area.
3-2 pitch, check swing to short. Derek Jeter over to Martinez, and that'll retire the side. But damage done here for Baltimore. It's a beautiful ballpark located in downtown Baltimore on the waterfront here that over the past few seasons has been rebuilt. It is a great tourist area now. Lots of conventions are held literally in the same area. A lot of convention hotels.
Suspend Garcia. Just what Richie needs.
The umpire has had the tough calls. He's at third base for this game. They found him in right field in game one. They found him in left field in game two. Will they find him at third base in game three? Cecil Fielder leads it off Mussina and fouls it back. Yankees will have Fielder, Strawberry, and Mariano Duncan do up here in the second inning. 5-for-18 overall in the playoffs, but only 1-for-7 against the Baltimore Orioles. Mike Mussina, the 19-game winner, gave up a lot of hits, second highest in the league. And a lot of home runs, as Rick talked about, 7th most home runs, including 22 that were hit here.
But you know what? Mussina's got a little chip on his shoulder right now. Let's take a look. The umpires, Riley, Morrison, Rowe, Garcia, Larry Barnett, and Dale Scott. But Mussina's got a little bit of a chip on his shoulder. He was bypassed in this series. And he's the ace of their staff. So he's really on a mission tonight to prove something.
Davey Johnson couldn't be happier about that little chip, right?
Exactly. I mean, that's what... And Davey Johnson, we talked about that one day of rain, how it changed the whole look of this series because he's able to pitch David Wells at Yankee Stadium if he has to twice. He moved Mussina back. He bypassed his start. And actually, it worked out for Davey Johnson. David Wells now 10-1 at Yankee Stadium lifetime.
The problem out in center field, I think, in the batter's eye as the home plate umpire asked for the timeout. Mike Riley, he was looking out at center and then talked with one of the grounds crew people who's going to get on the phone here. May have been a light on out there.
See, when we, Gary, when we talk about the batter's eye, that's that, so they can see it nice. What I think was the problem, there seems to be some lights just on beyond the batter's eye. I don't know if there's some camera crews set up, but that gives them a good background to see the ball.
So many members of the press, of course, here. Cecil Fielder's gone. Mike Mussina gets his second strikeout. He can do that too, Rick. He can K people.
Good strikeout pitcher because he's got 3 above average pitches. The fastball, the curve, and the changeup. If he's on his game, he's very difficult to hit.
He was 4th in strikeouts in the American League during the regular season, 204. Cecil Fielder's his second victim. Here's Darryl Strawberry. Strawberry put in the lineup to try and take advantage of what is a short distance to right field for a left-handed hitter, but a high wall scoreboard that you've got to get over to get the home run down there if you pull it in that corner. Fouls that one back, 1-1.
For a guy who hasn't seen a lot of action, that was a pretty good rip.
He is 0-for-6 in the playoff year. He's only had 1 at bat in this series. Veteran ball player who now has a bat not quite as quick through that strike zone as it used to be, but make a mistake and he can still launch it.
Well, the thing with Darryl, the way to pitch him is you try to throw fastballs above the belt because he's got a good low ball swing. You can see from his stance, he cocks up the bat, gets it up high, and he can really drop the bat head down on the low ball. He's got a big arc in his swing. So what they try to do, they try to run the fastball up and in on Darryl and then use the off-speed pitches.
Strawberry with a 2-1 count on him. The off-speed pitch misses outside here, 3-1.
I think part of the reason Darryl's in the lineup, he put on a performance here earlier in the year when they first signed him. He hit 2 home runs in the ball game, carried the Yankees to victory when they swept the Orioles right after the All-Star break.
Strawberry, and that is underneath the glove of Roberto Alomar. And Darryl Strawberry's got his first hit of this playoff year. A single up the middle coming with one down here in the second inning.
That ball exploded off of Darryl's bat. That looked like it was going to be a ball right at Alomar, but it got through the infield in a hurry. See the ball down? He can hammer that ball down. This ball, I'm telling you, that was rifled. How about this? Mr. October, Reggie Jackson, talking to Darryl Strawberry. He's a special assistant to George Steinbrenner.
During earlier batting practice today, maybe it worked. He's on. And the inside pitch misses to Mariano Duncan. 2-0 lead for the Orioles. Each team now with 2 hits. Duncan's a couple of hits and 8 at-bats in this series and 24-7 for 24. On the postseason play, Strawberry will be held at first by Rafael Palmeiro. Mike Mussina, breaking ball, Cal Ripken, Roberto Alomar, Palmeiro, they turn two. They had the 5th highest number of double plays in the regular season. That one helps Mike Mussina. Jimmy Key to Cal Ripken. Ripken has been a monster hitter against Jimmy Key. 356 in his career against Key with 1 home run. He has really torn it up here in the playoffs too. He's had a hot bat.
And what that tells me about Cal Ripken, that he's willing to give up a little bit. Take Jimmy Key to right center field. That's the guys that have the most success against Jimmy.
Left-hander's pitch inside to Ripken. 1-1. Cal's got a 14-game hit streak. Going back to the regular season, he's had a hit in every one of the playoff games the Orioles have been involved in. He is 23 for 58 during the streak. Think he's loving this all the way back to 83 when he had his last chance in postseason, knowing there aren't going to be a whole lot more of them.
That's exactly what I was just going to, 13 years. And I spoke to Cal about that. And he said, Rick, he said, my first year we were into it to the wire. Then we get into the World Series. He said, I thought that's the way it was supposed to be. I appreciate it a lot more now.
Those years where you're not even close, you suddenly realize how special it is. Jimmy Key working very carefully to him, misses inside. And the count goes to 3-1 on Ripken. Cal, obviously, the pride of Baltimore. That night when he broke Lou Gehrig's Iron Man record and did that tremendous run here at Camden Yards is one of baseball's great moments now. 3-1 delivery to him, and that'll even it up to a full count, 3-2.
And you were talking about how he signs autographs. This guy, he'll sign for hours. And I think even the night that he broke Gehrig's record, stayed around after the ball game for 2 hours signing autographs. You want a role model, this is a good guy to put your hat on.
Get that right. He was even signing autographs in New York. Stopped in the parking lot on his way in to sign for fans. Good pitch by Key. Fooled him on that one. Gets his first strikeout. Ripken retired.
Jimmy Key doesn't give in. He really works on a hitter's emotion. He wants them to be aggressive and overswing. He takes advantage of those type of guys. 3-2, he went to the changeup. And that frustrates a hitter. You think you're in the driver's seat against Jimmy Key when you're ahead in the count. Sometimes it plays against you.
It's the first out there on Ripken, and here's the designated hitter, Eddie Murray. And first ball hitting fouls it back. Murray's had a couple of hits and 8 at bats in this series. Overall in the playoffs, Eddie Murray has been productive for this team. He too is having a good postseason with that 8-for-23.
Seeing it also would figure Eddie Murray has struggled against Jimmy Key. 182 in his career, because Eddie's a good fastball hitter.
He, the left-hander, breaking ball misses down low. 1-1.
Okay, I don't know. I think I've noticed something different in Eddie Murray tonight. Looks like he's a little more straight up. Remember how we're so used to seeing him really crouch on that back leg? It almost appears to me that he's standing a little taller.
Outside corner strike to him. Why would he do that against Keeve?
Not a lot of success against him in his career. You have to adjust to that pitcher. Eventually you start saying, okay, I got to try something different. But you see right from that little take, his first move is off the baseball. You really have to take Jimmy Key to right center field to be successful.
One ball, two strike delivery. And Murray with a pitch outside lets that one go by. Eddie Murray, switch hitter, 246 off left-handers this year. Picked up 3 home runs off southpaws. Better numbers from the other side of the plate for his future Hall of Famer. Here the count is 2 balls, 2 strikes. Orioles have the 2-0 lead. Murray just protecting, fights it off.
A big thing with Jimmy Key also is Joe Girardi. You got to work the umpire behind the plate, Mike Riley. You want to tease him, see how far he's going to give you away. That's where Jimmy Key makes his living, down and away from right-handers. Early in the ball game, you want to establish a strike zone away and make Riley aware of it.
2-2 delivery again. Murray again not chasing Jimmy Key, trying to get him to reach.
See, you know who the best was at working an umpire, not the catcher but a pitcher, was Tommy John. Remember Tommy John?
Oh yeah.
Same type of pitcher as Jimmy Key. He used to bring baseballs into the umpire's room. Hey guys, how you doing? You want me to sign a couple for you? All of a sudden the strike zone kept getting bigger and bigger.
3-2 delivery and Murray's gone. Jimmy Key, 2 strikeouts here in the inning on Ripken and Eddie Murray.
Well, that's a perfect example, of what Jimmy Key. He will not give in. Ripken and Murray both strikeouts on 3-2 changeups. See Girardi sitting away, the changeup. Murray still says, I'm going to hit a fastball. Well, you're not getting a fastball. You have to start looking for the changeup.
2 down and the base is empty, and here's B.J. Surhoff. Takes the breaking ball on the inside corner. Left-handers like Surhoff hit only 168 off Jimmy Key this year. That's hardly showing up. Right-handers at 283. 0-1, that's why right there. 0-2.
Well, see, Jimmy's still got enough of a fastball. I always thought against pitchers like Jimmy Key, changeup, which is their best pitch, you stack the lineup with left-hand hitters because it really takes away that changeup down and in.
0-2 pitch and a base hit. Surhoff chasing one that probably was a ball, but one that was in close enough for him to turn on it. Gets a 2-out single here in the second inning. And that'll be hit number 3 off Key by the Orioles.
Jimmy tries to get a little fancy. Wants to come, you see the 0-2 base hit by Surhoff. He tried to drop down and throw it sidearm. See how he crossfires? He just got it up out over the plate. And Surhoff is a good high ball hitter.
So a 2 down, Orioles get Surhoff on, and their number 9 hitter, their catcher, Chris Hoyles, will take on Jimmy Key. Hoyles did not start the first game, started the second game yesterday, had an 0-for-3. And misses down low, ball 1.
Jimmy Key has one of the more deceptive moves for a left-hander. And the Orioles really don't run that much, but what Jimmy does, he breaks the plane of the rubber with his knee, not his foot.
That ball drilled by Hoyles, but right at him. Reigns is there and puts the line drive away. Second inning for the Orioles. No runs, a base hit. They leave a base runner on. Todd Zeal's home run in the first, though, has given them the 2-0 lead. Baltimore Orioles leading this one 2-0. They lost game one in New York. They protested the game on the home run where that young man, Jeff Mayer, pulled the ball over the fence. Richie Garcia was the umpire down the line in right field in that game. Said it was not fan interference. Then said afterward, well, after looking at the replay, yeah, I guess it really was fan interference. Baltimore protested and sent it into the league. Charlie Hayes leads it off here, and the pitch is taken for a strike. That protest was denied today.
And I think rightfully so, because it was a judgment call. They felt, the Orioles felt they had a chance. The Orioles felt they had a chance that they could win it.
Hayes towards the hole, Ripken on the backhand. And it gets away from Palmeiro. Good backup by Hoyles. And Hayes is on, leading off the Yankees' half of the third inning. An error probably on Ripken.
Well, Cal throws the ball from sidearm. See, he plants himself and then a little flip. He doesn't really get on top of the ball, so that's going to have a lot of sink to it. And Palmeiro's unable to make the play. But that's a routine play that Cal 99% of the time makes.
So an error charged. That'll put the leadoff man on as the throw skipped. That's one of those Palmeiro many times will come up with over there. But Cal's charged with the error. Ripken error. Now Girardi, the number 9 hitter for the Yankees. Runner on at first base, nobody out. And Mussina misses inside. We'll see whether or not the error has any impact here.
Game one, the Orioles really played sloppy defense, and that's something they've been noted for, having real good, solid defense and pitching over the years. This year's really been an exception with all the home runs they've hit.
They've made 6 errors here in the postseason so far. That's a pretty high number.
It is a high number, especially for a team. They went out, they spent all the money to acquire Alomar to help their defense. Ripken, you're usually very sure-handed. Zeal had a tough time in game one on ground balls.
Yankees get a little light shining through the crack in the door here to start this third inning. Girardi has gone 2-for-5 against the Orioles, takes the pitch inside, and a 2-0 count on Girardi. He's checking with Willie Randolph, third base coach. Mike Mussina behind on the count here, 2-0.
So when you have a pitcher like Mussina and you really can't run against, Torrey early in the year really used the hit and run well. He's got a guy up there in Girardi that can handle the bat. Not a bad situation for a hit and run.
Big hole over there on the right side. Runner being held. Cena's not been close on those three. 2 down, 1 up, 3-0.
So usually you want your pitcher to pick up the infielder. You made an error, you feel bad. Now it's up to the pitcher to pick you up, try to get the ground ball double play right back at Ripken. I know Ripken. He wants the ball hit to him right away.
Mussina does not walk a lot of batters, only 69 in the regular season. Gets the strike there. He had the 8th fewest walks per 9 inning for any American League pitcher.
The thing I've noticed about Mussina, a lot more aggressive today. I did his game in Cleveland. In the division series, using an awful lot of curveballs and changeups, a lot more fastballs today.
Girardi, 3-1 count. Hayes off first. There it is. Ripken, Alomar, redemption at hand. Second double play they've turned.
You want to get that ground ball as quick as you can to atone for the error. Mussina came back from a 3-0 count. Look at this. Look at how he prepares himself. Nice easy toss, and Alomar is one of the best in the business at turning the double play.
One of the great favorites of any pitcher. Ground ball double played. Kells a little more relaxed than he was a pitch ago right now.
Especially when it was a 3-0 count on Girardi.
Tom Mussina's got 2 down, nobody on. Here's Tim Raines. Leadoff batter for the Yankees, had a single in his first at bat. The Orioles have a 2-0 lead. Todd Zeal, the home run in the first inning. Mussina trying to protect that. Raines, the switch hitter, batting in that number one spot. And down to first base, Rafael Palmeiro. He'll take it there, and that'll do it. So the leadoff error is not costly. Baltimore Orioles have the 2-0 lead here over the Yankees, doing it as they did all year with a home run. You take a look at Camden Yards. More people came to see ball games here than any other ballpark in the American League. Number one attendance, well up over that 3 million mark. In game one at Yankee Stadium, we talked about this play. Jeter, the fly ball. Jeffrey Mayer, the youngster, reaches out, pulls it in. The protest. Garcia, the umpire. Nobody feels worse about calling it a home run.
Well, you know, you got to be honest. I mean, that's, you know, we hold the integrity of this game, and I think that's what it's all about, is being honest and going out there every day, giving it your best. And honestly, you know, when you make a mistake, you make an honest mistake. Believe me, there's nobody feels worse than I do. There's nobody. I know the pitcher felt bad. I know the right fielder felt bad. I know all the Orioles feel bad. I know the Oriole fans feel bad, but there's nobody that feels worse than I do.
But as we said, the protest was denied, as he and everybody else really expected it would be.
Very classy of Richie Garcia. I worked in front of him many times, and always a classy guy.
There are some signs here tonight, aren't there?
There are no little boys to save you here.
Brady Anderson leading it off here in the bottom half of the third inning. Singled and scored his first time up. Takes that breaking ball from Jimmy Key. Just missed on the outside corner. Two balls and one strike. Anderson 4-for-10 now in this series. He has had one home run in his career off Jimmy Key. Brady Anderson hit .251 against left-handers during the season. Did have 13 home runs off southpaws. And has a 3-1 count here.
And you know what's good, kids? When you're looking at this, he chokes up on the bat. He hit 50 home runs this year. See the knob of the bat? He chokes up about an inch and a half.
Got him. Got the strike on him, 3-2.
Just shows you don't have to be all the way down at the bottom of the bat to hit home runs. Better back control when you choke up. Try to make contact. And he just happened to hit 50 home runs. He doesn't even consider himself a home run hitter.
Surprise.
Yeah, surprise.
50 will put you there. 3-2 pitch to him. Center field, Bernie Williams. It's 4-10 to get to the wall out there, and that one won't make it. Anderson is retired. One away here in the third inning.
You look at Camden Yards. Homer friendly. Down the line, 333, 364 in the power alley in left field. But then it goes out to 410 where Brady just hit that ball. It even gets more inviting as you pan around to right center field, 373. I think it plays a lot shorter than that.
Sure appears that way, the way the balls fly out of here.
And it also looks like you can reach that big warehouse in right field. And I think Ken Griffey Jr. in the All-Star game actually did hit a ball off there. This year I watched a game on Sunday night, and I thought Mo Vaughn of the Red Sox was going to crush a window. That's how far he hit a ball.
It's a beautiful sight. That warehouse has really become part of the ballpark. It isn't. It's outside the ballpark beyond a patio area out there, but it is just beautiful. That is the longest building on the East Coast, that warehouse.
It's a beautiful building.
Yeah, it is. It's a grand old warehouse converted now into office space by the Orioles and by others. Restaurants in there, museums, shops. Great park. Great part of the park. 3-0 count on Todd Zeal, who had the two-run homer in the first inning. Zeal down to third, had the green light. Charlie Hayes. Zeal retired, two away here in the third inning.
You know, Gary, what I really like what they've done with the new ballparks. They kind of made them like the old style with all the new amenities. The fans are real close to the action. Look at that. That's not a bad seat. I don't see a glove. He doesn't. If you hit one up there, wow, he's a long way away, but still a good seat for the ball game.
Office space up top there goes to the Baltimore Orioles, those top two floors. Roberto Alomar, two down, nobody on. Alomar grounded out his first time up. 2-0 lead, Orioles on top. Jimmy Key, the left-hander, and misses. Oh, outside corner. One ball, one strike. Orioles, two runs, three hits, and an error. The Yankees, no runs, and two hits in the ballgame. Roberto Alomar, 3-for-11 in the series, takes it away, 2-1. Well, Robbie Alomar, obviously happy to be out of New York and back here to a much friendlier crowd that he faced in New York, but he faced up to it, played well, and just kept quiet after apologizing before game one. Right center field, Williams and Strawberry. Darryl Strawberry, and a mix-up. Williams makes the catch. For the third time in this series, we see a fly ball where the players do not communicate with one another, and it almost fell in. 2-0 lead for the Orioles as we go to the top of the fourth inning. Mike Mussina has walked none in, struck out two. The Orioles right-hander trying to get out of a big funk he's in, having lost his last six decisions against the Yankees. 0-3 this year, 2-6 in his career. Boy, that almost fell in. And then when they got back, Joe Torre got up. He knows the camera's on himself and the players, but you got to say something. You can't continue to have fundamental baseball not being played, and the Yankees have struggled with that. Previous occasions, it was Derek Jeter. Now he gets the two of them over together. It's the center fielder's call, of course. If he can get to it, he's supposed to. Mussina misses inside here. Derek Jeter at the plate. Jeter flied to right field his first time up. A couple of hits and eight at-bats against Mike Mussina in his career. That'll drive a manager crazy when your team's not playing fundamental baseball and you're in the playoffs. I mean, that's stuff that's supposed to be taken care of in spring training. Jeter takes that strike as Mussina worked away from him that time. Ball and two strikes on him. Cena, 90 wins, 41 losses in his career, 27 years old. See Jeter's numbers. Really a good start, even a better finish, and a great postseason so far. One-two delivery to him. Chased it, got him. Three strikeouts for Mike Mussina. This right-hander looks like he is on in this ballgame. He got that one down in the strike zone with great movement on it, that knuckle curve that he can throw when it's moving right off the plate almost, really, when Jeter went after that one, and Hoyles made sure and tagged him out.
Well, they really think they found something, Gary. They think that Jeter has a tough time with the curveball. They haven't been able to get him out all year. And now they all of a sudden, after yesterday and David Wells, they think the curveball is one of his weaknesses.
So until he hits it, that's what he'll see.
He's going to see a lot of them.
Bernie Williams. Williams, a switch hitter. 278 right-handed, 270 left during the regular season. 29 home runs on the year. 13 of them came from the left side. Messina's getting ahead in the count on these hitters now. This is outside with that. One ball, one strike. Williams with a 476 batting average in postseason now. Had enormous numbers versus the Orioles this year as well. Yankees, of course, won 10 of the 13 games these teams played. Down the left field line towards the seats and a foul ball. One ball, two strikes on Williams.
Just seems like Mussina has really picked it up, using his fastball, his curveball, his changeup. The double plays have really helped him.
Two double plays turned in this game already for him. The fans here rocking along with him. Hasn't walked anybody, has struck out three. Off the fist, popped up. Hoyles back, no play. Count remains, a ball and two strikes.
Remember, we talked about how Mussina really wants to try to establish himself as a big game pitcher. There's been a little knock against him that He hasn't been able to pitch in a big ball game. He said he gets very testy about that also. He says, what about the clinching game against the Blue Jays? 8 innings. You know, so he's testy. He needs to prove something tonight to Davey Johnson, and all the media are following the Orioles.
I think you were right, Rick. The one term tonight is that aggressiveness. He really looks like he can't wait to get it going, get the ball back, throw it again, go ahead, try and hit it. Really challenging the hitters.
Yeah, a lot more aggressive in the strike zone.
Two balls, two strikes on him. Davey Johnson hoping it stays that way. Oriole manager on the right. 2-2 the count, base is empty, one away. Breaking ball missed up high. 3-2. Very tough man to strike out. Bernie Williams was called out on strikes in his first at bat.
You know, Williams just keeps getting better each year. Power hitter, switch hitter, good power from both sides of the plate.
3-2 delivery to him. Breaking ball, draws the walk. Mussina thought he had that one. First walk given up by the Oriole right-hander. Comes with one away in the fourth inning.
Did not want to give in to Bernie Williams. Went with the 3-2 changeup. Look at the tumbling action. And that's a tough pitch to lay off of, especially when you're looking fastball. Look at the tumbling action just out of the strike zone, down and away.
Mike Mussina with a runner on at first base and one away. Can the Orioles turn their third double play of this game? Yankees have left only one on. They have only two hits. Tino Martinez, ball one. Martinez hit into a fielder's choice his first time up.
I wonder what Joe Torre saw in a couple of bats yesterday that made him feel that Tino Martinez and Cecil Fielder were just about ready to start unloading. Maybe wishful thinking, because he really needs them to produce to win.
Wanting to pump him up a little bit, saying so publicly.
Yeah, but maybe, I mean, he actually is telling us and a lot of the media around. Maybe he wants the players to hear that. He's, you know, he's not lost any confidence. He's definitely lost confidence in O'Neill and Boggs because of the lineup changes today, which is something that Joe Torre has really not done the entire year.
Boggs with that bad back and not hitting, as we said. O'Neill sitting right next to him right there. Got that deep hamstring problem. Inside corner strike. I really think O'Neill is much worse than is being said.
Oh, his hamstring is killing him.
He's limping all over the place.
And you know he wants to be out there. This is tough when you have two of your best left-hand hitters on the bench in postseason time. Against the right-hand pitcher.
Yeah, right where you want him.
Yeah.
One ball, two strikes, one away. Williams at first base. Tino Martinez at the plate. It'll stay a ball and two strikes. Yeah, those are the things that oftentimes affect postseason play. You've got to have the people you go with, the ones who got you there, ready to go. And the Yankees have had to struggle with that here in postseason this year.
And what makes it even worse is that they're not hitting. The buildup to this series was going to be the Yankee pitching versus the Orioles hitting. But you still have to be able to produce runs, do the little things it takes to win ball games. The Yankees have not been able to do that. They're very fortunate to be where they are today.
1-2 delivery again. Martinez again got jammed, but is able to foul that back off the fist. He's battling here. One ball, two strike count on him. Mike Mussina coming inside that time after setting it up with one away before that.
Oh, that's what makes it so tough too, because he's got a good enough fastball. He keeps you honest inside and then looks to get you out away with the split finger.
Series tied at one apiece. Three games to be played here in Baltimore. Best of seven. Runner goes and a base hit into right field. Williams is on his way to third. Bobby Bonilla will get it back in. And Martinez delivers a single with Williams on the fly, and the Yankees, with one away, have runners at the corners here in the fourth inning.
pretty gutsy call by Torrey, sending Bernie Williams in motion. He stayed with the 3-2 breaking ball and drilled it in the hole.
Torrey trying to make it happen, Rick. Things aren't going well. Rev it up.
Yeah, try to get this lineup going.
Get people moving. Get things happening.
You don't want to play stupid baseball and run yourself out of innings, but you got to stay aggressive.
Now, first and third, three hits off Mike Mussina. And here's Cecil Fielder, struck out swinging his first time up. This is where the Yankees have not been able to get big hits with runners in scoring position. They are 2-for-24. Down to third base. Zeal, one relay on Fielder. Is not in time, and a run scores. Even Cecil able to beat that one out. Bernie Williams crosses the plate with the Yankees' first run. It is 2-1. Martinez taken out at second base on the forced play.
And the only reason that's not a double play, the ball wasn't hit hard enough to Zeal. See, Bernie's going to move on contact, but the ball's just not hit hard enough to Zeal. Alomar does a nice job turning it, but a nice slide also. See, Bernie scoring. Cecil legs it out at first, and a nice job by Tino Martinez going in hard at second to try to disrupt Alomar.
So the Yankees still do not get a hit with runners in scoring position, but they do get a run, and they make it 2-1. Now Fielder's on at first base with two down, and Darryl Strawberry, who singled his first time up, takes the pitch away. Oriole lead cut by one for Cecil Fielder. That'll be his sixth RBI of the playoffs. He may not run fast, but he did run hard. Lumbering down there to try and avoid the double play and got there about a step ahead. Because he's not a base runner at first, even with the left-hander, especially with the left-hander Strawberry up, Palmeiro will play behind Cecil Fielder in order to try and cut down Strawberry's chances of driving one into right field.
Yeah, I don't think they have to worry about Cecil trying to steal a base.
If he does, he'll come out of the lineup. You can be pretty sure of that.
The funny thing is, he did steal a base this year. The first time in his major league career, he wanted the bag. He wanted second base. Give me that base.
He saw Ricky do it. He said, why can't I?
Ricky said, you got to get about 1,000 more.
And the 2-0 pitch is down low, and Strawberry's got a 3-0 count.
You turn him loose if you're Torrey?
Yes.
I think so. That's the aggressive type of baseball. You hope Darryl, a veteran player, will get himself a good pitch to hit, look for a ball in a certain area, and then try to drive it.
See if he's got it. 3-0 pitch. Well, that was a good pitch.
Good pitch on the outside part of the plate, but by his intention, it looked like he was ready to pull the trigger.
Only going to go if he got one down the middle.
That's the whole thing. You can't wait to the last minute to hit. See, you can see he's got everything ready to make a pass at the ball. You have to recognize the pitch and then swing.
3-1 count here, and Strawberry got jammed. Fouls this back. Mussina coming up and in on him, and it goes to a 3-2 count with two down. Cecil Fielder will be running this time with a two away.
Remember, they try to pitch Strawberry up in the strike zone. Mussina could go two ways here, the high fastball or the split finger.
3-2 delivery. Strawberry's gone. He pulled the string on him. Off-speed delivery on the splitter. But the Yankees come up with a run on a hit. They leave a one on base. It is now a 2-1 Orioles lead. Rafael Palmeiro takes the pitch up high. Two balls, no strikes. He flied out his first time up.
And if you saw the winning pitcher for the St. Louis Cardinals, that name was pretty familiar. Stottlemyre. That's Todd Stottlemyre.
Towards second base, and Mariano Duncan. Palmeiro retired, one away in the fourth.
And you think his dad, Mel Stottlemyre, the pitching coach, had one eye on that set? That Yankee game wasn't over by the time.
His wife, Jean, in the parking lot. She left the Yankee game early to go out into the car and listen to the radio to hear her son pitching in Atlanta. Jean was, she says, I can't take this anymore. Now it's not just one game. I got my husband coaching one team and my son pitching for another. And how about if they were to meet up in the World Series?
Who does she pull for?
When he's pitching, she would not cheer against her son. No matter what Dad said.
Could not do that.
Bobby Bonilla. And the pitch by Jimmy Key is outside, one away here in the fourth inning. Bonilla grounded out his first time up, still looking for his first hit in the series. As he has gone 0 for 9 now against the Yankees. Pitch is taken down low.
You mentioned only four hits in his last 44 at bats, three of them being home runs. The grand slam and a solo home run in the division series against the Indians. So production is still there when he makes contact.
And this one is popped up to shallow right center. Williams, Strawberry, and Duncan. And it's Mariano Duncan, the second baseman, who puts that one away for the second out. I think every time there's a fly ball at pop-up, Joe Torre comes to the front steps.
You know, the one difference there is that Mariano Duncan really took charge on that one. I mean, he went hard. There was no doubt about it. He's calling everybody off. And look at the other guys, Bernie, Strawberry. Now they're all hustling, trying to communicate. That's been a problem for the Yankees all year long.
It's so hard to believe. I mean, it's so fundamental, talking to your teammates out there defensively. Key's pitch to Ripken is outside for a ball. 1-0 count. Corey Kelly struck out his first time up. Kell here at the home yard saw the numbers for him. Better on the road. Pitch is taken away. The Orioles won 43 games though here at home. This is a ballpark they did very well in.
See, most pitchers are in trouble when they get behind 2-0. I mentioned earlier in the game that it actually works to Jimmy Key's benefit because he doesn't have to change his pitching pattern. He can stay with the changeup, the off-speed pitches. He still throw pitches off the plate away. And the funny thing is most pitchers are in a lot of trouble 2-0 because hitters can sit on fastball, take all the guessing out of it. Not in Jimmy Key's case.
You keep on throwing that off speed stuff no matter what. That is his forte. Ripken with a 2-1 count, two down, bases empty. Takes the pitch inside. Orioles have the 2-1 lead in this game three. We are in the bottom half of the fourth inning. Jimmy Key with 164 wins in his career. 164 and 104. Lifetime, 36 year old left-hander. 3-1 delivery. And Ripken pops that one up. Behind the mound. Who'll get this? Duncan. It's a scary affair, isn't it, when you get those pop-ups?
Everybody else backing off, and Jeter backed off, but Duncan took charge.
Get a look at Camden Yards here in Baltimore, the Chesapeake Bay region. Darryl Jeter, one of the visitors here for the New York Yankees.
You know, you talk about an infielder. Let's see how Derek Jeter gets himself ready. See, the ball's just about ready to be delivered, gets himself in position. See the feet moving, now the pop-up. You just don't stand still. You have to have some movement, get yourself ready in case the ball is hit to you.
He seems to always be in the right place, too, doesn't he? His moves are right.
His moves are right.
Mariano Duncan leads it off against Mike Mussina. Mussina has walked one, struck out four. Run coming on the fielder's choice in the fourth inning off Mussina with the RBI credited to Cecil Fielder. Yankees have stranded a couple in the ballgame. Duncan hit into a double play his first time up, one of two double plays turned by the Orioles infield. Scooped up by Hoyles, one ball, one strike.
The thing that makes Duncan such a good hitter, 340 this year, is that he hits the ball from line to line, left field all the way down to the right field line. Very good high ball hitter.
1-1 pitch to him is fly ball to right field, fairly straight away for Bobby Bonilla. Duncan is retired, one away here in the fifth inning. Two pitchers walked in a pretty good one right now.
Pretty good game, and this is how it's been all year long. 59 pitches for Mussina, pretty good ball strike ratio. Most important pitch is that first one. Work ahead in the count, makes it a little bit easier for you.
Mike Mussina in the three losses he had against the Yankees this year gave up 11 runs on 19 hits in 15 and two thirds innings. I mean, he got tagged this season by Yankee hitters.
The best game he had was here right after the All-Star game. Came out in the eighth inning, tie score, Derek Jeter home run beat him.
One run ball game going here. Charlie Hayes reached on an error, will back off. A 1-0 count on him. Play Hayes straight away. In for Wade Boggs at third base. Not a great disparity in the numbers. There's Boggs, who's sitting it out. All the writers are gathered around Wade Boggs for his comments and why he's not in, but not much he can say at this point. The back hurts and he's not hitting well. What are you going to do if you're the manager?
He's made some changes.
Yeah, he makes some changes. And there are plenty of press people here to ask questions. And the pitch is taken down low. You have to put an auxiliary press area in all of these ballparks for postseason. The normal press box cannot hold the number of people who come to cover. We are located, of course, behind home plate. The auxiliary press box is barely in the ballpark. It's in the overhang out there in left.
No, that's not fair, because there's not a bad seat in the house here.
And the 3-0 pitch is taken down low, and he's on.
I got a funny little story about that temporary where the media sit. That's where we are, back behind home plate. But in the left field bleachers out there in the division series, they roped it off, but they forgot there wasn't going to be that many press here. Then they had to resell the tickets late. They were scrambling. Well, the whole ballpark was packed, and all of a sudden just two sections were left empty.
Yeah, you can get some money for those tickets, though.
They said, we made a mistake.
Go back out on the street. Towards short and out of the reach. Joe Girardi's got a base hit as Ripken dove and couldn't get it. And the Yankees here in the fifth inning with one down get a walk and a single by Girardi, two on, trailing 2-1.
And the reason that's a base hit is because Ripken is up real close for the double play. That cuts down his range, and this ball gets through the infield in a hurry. So you can't even see Ripken in this picture. But look at how much dirt is still left between Ripken. See where he starts? Ripken, he has to go back on the ball. A lot of dirt before the grass. He's playing shallow to try to make the double play.
So the Yankees are threatening. That is the fourth hit they've had off Mike Mussina. All have been singles. Runners on at first and second. Hayes at second base. Girardi on at first. And the leadoff batter, Tim Raines, who has singled and grounded out, will stand in.
So it's the ping-pong attack of the Yankees against the bashers from the Orioles.
Station to station, Yankee baseball
little,
right now.
Little Nintendo baseball, one base at a time.
Tim Raines. And a ground at a second base, not hit hard. Alomar's only play will be at first. He will get Raines. The base runners move up. Now there are two down.
And now the Yankees are 2-for-26 with runners in scoring position in this series. Postseason
that's unbelievable.
Play. In postseason play. 2-for-26.
This New York Yankee team left more people on base during the regular season than any other team in the American League. That is coming back to haunt them a bit here in the postseason now, where you don't get that many chances to get runs.
There's Chris Chambliss, the hitting coach for the New York Yankees. Puts a lot of time and effort in helping the hitters.
Here's a big at-bat. Derek Jeter, breaking ball. Misses down low.
See the curveball? Curveball, curveball. Kid, you can't hit it. That's what they think. This kid has been able to adjust and handle just about anything they've tried to throw his way. Another curveball. See it down.
Two on. Hayes at third. Girardi at second base. Jeter off the fist. Fouls it off. And Mike Mussina evens the count up here at a ball and a strike. Big moment in this ball game. This is where the Yankees need to come through with one. A base hit with two down here. Both runners will go on contact. Could put the New York Yankees on top.
And you know what happens when you start reading the papers and you say we're struggling with men in scoring position? You start getting a little over anxious. Tim Raines swinging at the first pitch from Mussina with runners in scoring position. There, Jeter went out of the strike zone on that fastball.
1-1 pitch to him. He stays off that. Two balls and one strike. 22-year-old shortstop who during the regular season hit .271 with runners in scoring position.
Look at that. Followed the ball all the way back to the catcher's mitt. Who made that famous? Pete Rose. Remember all the time he took a pitch, he'd follow it all the way back.
Jeter loves to lean out over the plate too on those pitches. He almost falls over watching it. That one is popped up outside of first. Palmeiro moving over will not have a play. It evens the count though at two balls and two strikes on Derek Jeter.
Another bad pitch. Ball, fastball up in the strike zone. You still have to be patient. I know you want to drive in runs, but you can only take what the pitcher gives you. If he's not going to give you a strike, you got to be patient until you get one and then try to hit it hard. Just what you were talking about. Likes to lean in with his top half of his body. Can handle the ball away very well.
Two balls, two strikes, two down and two on. Mike Mussina to Jeter. Fly ball, right center field, not deep. Roberto Alomar, the second baseman, puts it away. And Mussina works his way out of it. No runs, a base hit, but two are left on in scoring position. The Orioles leading 2-1. There is a freeze warning in effect for the outlying areas here in the Baltimore region tonight. It was 57 at game time. You can see bundled up more like a football game than for a baseball game here on this 11th day of October.
There's a heater. See that? Don't worry about your hands, your feet. Make sure your baby, that little bat, is nice and warm. Look at that.
Heater right there blowing that heat out into the dugout for B.J. Surhoff. Eddie Murray leading it off, and a key misses down low with it. Murray, Surhoff, and Hoyles here in the fifth inning.
Now I'm just wondering, did the Orioles treat the Yankees to a heater in their dugout, or is it all one way? Keep their players warm, but okay, that's all. That's what we wanted to find out.
Keeping it honest.
They're being nice.
Murray struck out his first time up, one of two strikeouts for Jimmy Key in the game. That pitch is up high. Two balls and no strikes on Murray. Key has walked none and struck out two. Key went 8-6 on the road this year for the Yankees, 4-5 at home. He's up to 66 pitches. And it's 3-0 on Eddie Murray.
Jimmy Key's settled in nicely. First two hitters of the ball game, Brady Anderson, leadoff single to right. Curveball to Todd Zeal, two-run homer. He's settled down. He's only given up one hit in the last three innings.
Only three hits off him. Murray's taking all the way. Todd Zeal's two-run homer in the first inning after Brady Anderson had singled. Gave the Orioles the 2-0 lead. Yankees getting one back. Two great veterans here. Fans chanting Eddie, Eddie. And Murray's on with a leadoff walk. First given up by Key.
No room for panic in Joe Torre. He's thinking. His eyes are always moving. Trying to keep his eyes on everything possible, but just in case he doesn't. You got Mel Stottlemyre, pitching coach. Jose Cardinal moving the outfielders around. He's the outfield coach.
B.J. Surhoff delivered a single his first time up. Despite the fact left-handers struggle so much against Jimmy Key, Surhoff now has gone 12 for 37 in his career off Jimmy Key. Pretty darn good hitting.
Just like that. You mentioned something and it appears.
It's a technology. Magnificent, isn't it?
It's unbelievable.
2-0.
The one thing about B.J. Surhoff, not your typical left-hand hitter. He starts his stance with a flat bat. In other words, the bat is parallel to the ground. That enables him to hit more high balls than the average left-hand hitter.
Runner at first, nobody out. Surhoff down to first. Got to put a tag on now. Runners out at first. The rundown play, Martinez will tag him, a double play. Tino Martinez immediately went to the bag. That took Surhoff out. Then they had to put a tag on Eddie Murray, and they do. And there are now two down. So that takes care of the leadoff walk. And a good play by Martinez. We have some video technical problems we apologize for. We'll do a little radio for you here with Chris Hoyles coming up. Two down, nobody on. Yeah, bottom half of the fifth. Wide out to left field, his first time up. And the delivery to him misses down low from the left-hander Key. Ball one. Apologize for the technical problems. Back with you with the pictures.
They always said you had a face for radio.
And they were always right. Hoyles. Two balls and no strikes. Chris Hoyles with a 2-0 pitch. Do you think anybody is watching tonight in Zermatt, Switzerland? Do we have a chance?
Definitely.
One of my favorite places in the world. You ever been there?
I've been.
It is magnificent. It's a ski resort area.
I've been to Lucerne.
Yeah, that's close. Foul back.
See, you didn't know I was a world traveler.
Oh, yeah, I knew that. It was never a doubt in my mind.
You know the difference tonight that I've seen? Mike Riley. The home plate umpire, a little more pitcher-friendly strike zone. He's willing to bend a little bit, give a little bit of the outside part of the plate. Remember Mussina actually getting the inside fastball called strikes. You call strikes, the game moves along a little quicker.
It's done that. 2-2. He got him. So Jimmy Key gets his third strikeout, a leadoff walk, but he faces only three, helped out by the double play. No runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left. It remains Baltimore 2 and the Yankees 1. Welcome back to Baltimore, everybody. Gary Thorne and the worldwide traveler Rick Cerrone as the Orioles have a 2-1 lead, sixth inning.
You caught me by surprise, but I had an answer for you. Lucerne.
Well, there's no, I wanted to say hello in case somebody in Zermatt was listening, because it's right at the Matterhorn, a great ski resort, wonderful people, and great food.
Now, if you had a restaurant over there, you would really impress me.
If you spent as much money as I do over there, you could have a restaurant. Here's Bernie Williams, and he takes the pitch outside for a ball as we go to the sixth inning. Two runs, three hits, an error for the Orioles. The error was not costly. The Yankees, one run, four hits, no errors. The Yankees have not been able to come up with the big hit to get somebody home, as they have stranded four in the game, two in scoring position. Orioles have left only one on base. They got the Zeal home run, and since then they have been shut down. Williams with a 2-0 count.
We always talk about manufacturing runs in postseason play, because you're always going against the 1, 2, 3 pitchers, the top three pitchers on a staff. You don't see that number 4 or 5 guy that you might see during the season. So runs really become a premium.
And a strike taken. Bernie Williams drew a walk in the fourth inning with one away and came on to score the Yankee run. Joe Torre ready to talk to the home plate umpire a bit, I think.
Yeah, but he's been consistent tonight. Mike Riley's called strikes from the first inning. As a hitter, you see that, you got to be a little more aggressive up there.
And that one is down low, 3 balls and 1 strike. I mentioned Mike Mussina does not walk many. And in this kind of a ball game, you really don't want to give him up. But Bernie Williams chases very few bad pitches. You know, he doesn't help you out if you're the opposing pitcher.
See him shake his head twice. The pitcher controls what he's going to throw. The catcher just merely suggests it.
Except when you were catching. 3-1 pitch and a chopper to second base. Nice play. A little bit of the gold glove there.
Well, you know, that is just, you know, versatile, because that ball, he expected to come up. It stayed down right at the last minute. He had a change. Look at this. See how he prepares on the balls of his feet? But that ball was supposed to come up, an off-balance throw. He made that look pretty easy.
He's some kind of ball player. Really unfortunate, the controversy had to surround him, the off-field stuff, and take away from what he does on it. One away here in the sixth inning, and Tino Martinez is single in the fourth inning. Reached on a fielder's choice his other time up, has that one bounced by him all the way to the screen. Martinez, 231 in postseason play. After his strong 292 performance during the regular season, ended up tied for the RBI lead on the Yankees with 117. He and Cecil Fielder both had 117. Cecil, of course, did not play the whole year in New York. 53 games, the other with the Detroit Tigers. Fouls that one back up overhead. 1-1.
It's amazing. The Oriole pitching staff has not been given a lot of credit. But this is the seventh game in postseason. They had four against the Cleveland Indians and now three against the Yankees. Their starter has gotten into the sixth inning or better in every start.
That one is fouled off outside of third.
Think back to the pitching performance yesterday of David Wells. He went 6 2/3 and some tough innings. And there's the coaching staff. That's Rick Down on the left, the hitting instructor. Pat Dobson, the pitching coach. Andy Etchebaren scratching his head. And the manager, Davey Johnson.
One ball, two strikes on Tito Martinez. One down, base is empty. Mike Mussina got it in, foul back. A little bit ironic that the Yankee pitching staff has not had a victory from their starters since September 25. That's 10 wins ago. It has been their bullpen that they've had to go to get the W.
And the bullpen has been a strength of the Yankees, but eventually you need a starter to step up. Jimmy Keyes really settled down after the first inning, but he's still on the losing end.
Martinez, Alomar, can he get it? Oh yeah!
Gold glove winner Robbie Alomar, six straight. He showed you on that little in-between hop before. Now on the sinker from Mussina, ball hit in the hole. Now normally this should be a base hit. Look at the range, the slide, and the accurate throw.
Robbie Alomar's inning.
Remember the Oriole defense. We talked, that's always been a strength of their teams in the past. We love you, man.
Love you, man. Cecil Fielder takes a strike. These two teams rank 2 and 3 in the league in fielding percentage. Another reason why we've been surprised some of the fundamental mistakes they've made. That's the kind of play you expect to see from these two ball clubs defensively. Two down, bases empty, and 0-1 count. Cecil Fielder, 0-for-2, does have an RBI on a ground ball. The lone Yankee run batted in, a ball and a strike on him.
10 ground ball outs for Mussina now. That's his style, with that sinker, the fastball, the split finger. Works down in the strike zone, gets a lot of ground balls.
Remember, Mussina's not beaten the Yankees in his last six decisions against them. Fouled off.
The last time he actually beat him was in 1993.
93.
And this is the guy that won 19 ball games this year, was unable to beat the Yankees this year. He was 0-3. Last year he was 0-2. It's been a while since he's had a W against the Yankees.
Fans on their feet. One ball, two strike count on Cecil Fielder. Got him. In a one-run ball game, have the lead going to the bottom of the sixth inning. Over 3,600,000 fans showed up for baseball here this year. They averaged over 45,000 a game at Camden Yards. It is a magnificent place, as Rick mentioned earlier, to watch a game from. Just beautiful. Great seats. You're on top of the play. It's a lovely ballpark. The fans do love it, and they've seen a good one here tonight. Brady Anderson, the leadoff batter, singled and flied out. Bottom half of the sixth inning.
That is one of the rarities in baseball now. Back to the natural grass. All four teams in the championship series playing on natural grass. St. Louis, they took out the carpet and put in grass.
So glad they did. And did he go? They want to check at third. Yes.
Hey, there's Richie.
We wondered where he'd been.
Hey, Richie. There he is. International star now. Richie Garcia. That's the first call he's had to make on the. Remember, he even talked about it. The check swing.
And the Orioles fans just needed one chance, the first chance they've had, to give him a Bronx cheer in Baltimore. Brady Anderson. Breaking ball missed outside to him. One ball, two strikes on the Orioles leadoff batter. Four hits, 11 at bats in the series. It is tied. The series is at one apiece. Best of seven. Winner goes on to the World Series. Orioles have the 2-1 lead in this ball game. 1-2 to Anderson, and he chased the breaking ball. Jimmy Key gets his fourth strikeout, one away in the sixth inning.
Well, remember the ball that he tried to go sidearm to B.J. Surhoff on a fastball. He got it up in the strike zone. This time he goes sidearm with the slider. Look at that. It just keeps moving away and away from Brady Anderson. As a hitter, you see it. You try to go with it, but that ball's just breaking too much. Like a big frisbee.
Awful tough to hang in when he drops down and comes from that first base side with that delivery. Todd Zeal. So far, the big blow in the game came from this guy in the first inning. Anderson led the bottom half of the first off with a single, and Zeal delivered the home run. This one taken inside, it looked like this.
Right in the first inning, didn't look like it was going to be a long inning or a long day for Jimmy Key. The curveball, middle in, and that ball got out of here in a hurry.
Those are the two runs that are up there for the Baltimore Orioles. Called strike in the inside corner. Ball and two strikes on Zeal. Two home runs in the postseason now for Todd Zeal. Both have come against the Yankees. One down, nobody on. Zeal takes that one in the dirt.
See, I think if you broke down Jimmy Key's pitches by percentage, you would say 80% of Jimmy Key's pitches are going to be down and away from a right-hand hitter on the outside part of the plate. The other 20% are going to be inside, but only 10 for strikes. He wants to show you the ball in and get you out of way.
Now, the inside pitch is a setup pitch, right, to go back outside with.
It didn't used to be that way. It used to be pitchers used to try to break it up, but it's gotten so much more away, away, away. So he just stays down there. That's where he makes his living. He hopes the hitters will chase bad pitches.
3-2 delivery. It'll stay that way as Zeal fouls it off.
The amazing thing, Gary, is that hitters will still look for the ball inside. And if the guy is going to show you, he's going to throw you nothing but away, away, away. Move up on the plate and try to take him to right center field.
Make the adjustment. Yeah, make the adjustment. And that's what we were talking about. Some hitters have done here that we've noted in this game. 3-2 delivery again to Zeal, and again he chops it foul. Stays at a full count. Zeal acquired by the Orioles along with Pete Incaviglia from Philadelphia for a couple of pitchers on August 29, adding some more power to the Baltimore lineup and the third baseman. 3-2 the count.
Little change up coming from Jimmy Key.
Fights that one down the first baseline, checking to see if he broke his bat on that thing. Look at the laugh going on by Girardi.
He's saying, and if I'm Girardi, I used to say a grown man hit that ball. A big man like you hit a ball that soft. But that's what a Jimmy Key can do to a right-hand hitter. Frustrate you, make you look embarrassing against a change up. Wow.
You swing with everything you've got. And the ball goes about 10 feet.
And it's so soft.
You have to look at your bat after that.
Oh,
so that the 40, 50,000 people at least could say, well, he broke his bat. Otherwise, it would have gone further.
He's got that little smirk on his face. He said, maybe I should turn this bat around and use the knob to hit it.
He probably went back and came out with the same bat.
He needs it about a foot longer if he's going to keep going after that changeup down and away.
Jimmy Key again with a 3-2 delivery. And Zeal again fights it off.
Oh, this is a great at bat just to see how Jimmy Key really pitches. Away, away, away. He's shown Zeal two balls on the inside part of the plate tonight, both for balls. The only time he wants to throw strikes is down and away. A little fastball coming.
3-2 again. Up in the air, right field, Strawberry. Got room. Two down.
But what did Zeal do in that at bat? He kind of conceded. He said, I got to force myself to go the other way. He hit the fly ball, but that very easily could have been a line drive base hit to right center field. Look at Girardi. He's actually sitting up off the plate. He gets maybe a little bit too much of the plate, but you can see by that swing, his effort is trying to take Jimmy Key to right center field.
Took Jimmy Key 10 pitches to get Todd Zeal out on that at bat. But he got him out. Two down, Roberto Alomar. Alomar in the ball game has flied out and grounded out in his two at-bats. He is 5-for-19 lifetime against left-hander Jimmy Key. Alomar takes the fastball inside corner that time. One ball, one strike.
Switch
Alomar
hitter.
276 postseason.
Switch hitter, maybe a little more power from the right side of the plate.
Got ourselves a humdinger going here in game three as these two pitchers, Mike Mussina and Jimmy Key, have really locked it in. Two runs, three hits for the Orioles, a run on four hits for the Yankees. And we are now in the sixth inning. Somebody will have a 2-1 lead in this series before we leave Camden Yards tonight. Popped up, right field, curving towards the seat, Strawberry over, and has room. Darryl Strawberry pulls it in. Those balls just can't stay away from the fans here in this series. And the Baltimore fans are booing the crowd down there about why somebody didn't reach out and interfere with Darryl Strawberry. Sides retired in order. Still a one-run ball game.